Yeah, so should we go? It's 26 over, so I guess we can go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so can you see my screen now, this metaprogramming notebook?
I can.
Okay, perfect. So first I'll give a quick motivation of what is metaprogramming and why is it important. Then as a motivation example, one quick application of metaprogramming. So we will use a macro, and macro is like the hero of metaprogramming. And we will show how we can use macros to make code development easier and cleaner. And then finally, we will talk about how to do metaprogramming ourselves. So expressions in Julia and create our own macros. So metaprogramming in a nutshell is programming about programming. So when you do metaprogramming, you write a code that writes code. And the reason for which you can do it in Julia is that Julia is what language theorists call a homoiconic language, which means that in Julia, Julia code has a type. So Julia represents Julia code itself with a data type. So in Julia, you can represent Julia code. And so when I create a macro, and in Julia, macro is distinguished by this at symbol. So yesterday we saw something at time run, for example. If I run this, it will time how long it takes to run this function. And what this at macro does, this at macro is a function. Well, it's a macro, but what is a macro? A macro is kind of a function which takes as input the Julia code. So the input of the macro is the Julia code. And the way this Julia code is represented is as an expression. So when it takes this macro, it takes as input the Julia code parsed in abstract syntax tree. So it knows the Julia syntax and it can like analyze it and modify it. And we will see it soon. And before we get starting to see how macros are used, how to create macros and how to represent expressions, let's see a simple example when metaprogramming can make our life easier. So let's define, like yesterday, a type struct my integer, okay, which has just a type, which is an integer, similar to what we did yesterday, okay? Now, suppose I want to define the operations on these. So I want to define addition, multiplication, subtraction, division on the integers. And I just wanted to do the same thing that would do on normal integers. So what I would like to define, I want to define that plus of x my integer and y my integer is my integer of x, it's my integer of x plus type a plus x plus y. So it's just my integer with the sum of the integers inside my integers. And then I want to do the same for minus x my integer, y my integer is my integer x dot a minus x dot y. And that's annoying because I need to type a lot of mechanical code because the structure is exactly the same. Operator, x my integer, y my integer, equal to my integer, attribute of the first, same operator, attribute of the second. And that's extremely annoying. Like, I don't want to do it myself because I want to write a code which will generate for me all this repetitive code because I'm lazy. And so how do we do it? Okay, first, short interlude. If I want to extend this, I first do import base plus minus times. Actually, division between two integers is not an integer. So let's take just plus minus and multiplication. So now I can define those functions. But instead of defining each one manually, I will write a macro in a for loop that does it for me. So I will start with a for operator in And now I give a list of operators, so plus. And now when I put this column here, it means that it's a symbol. So this is the symbol plus, this is the symbol minus, and this is the symbol, no, of course it doesn't work now, star. At this point, it's okay to think that the symbol is similar to a string. It's actually very different, but for our purposes, you can think of it just as a symbol indeed, just as a string, okay? Then what I want to do is that I want to define the plus of A, my integer, and B, my integer. So I would like to define this plus A, my integer, B, my integer is equal to my integer A plus A plus A plus, B plus A. That's my goal. And now if we observe the structure, the first symbol is the operator. So just like string interpolation, we do now expression interpolation. So dollar sign op, and this will like substitute here the value of op, which should be plus minus star. Then I will do A, my integer, B, my integer equal to my integer A plus, so now if it's the first time you do this thing, you will probably do the same mistake that I was about to do. So you probably now would like to write A plus A dollar op B plus A. It's a very common mistake. I did it a lot of times, I still do it, but that doesn't really work. So you cannot interpolate in the expression with infix notation. So you need to write it like this. Okay. So this now is an expression. It's a valid syntax of Julia code, because when I replace operator with plus, this would read plus my integer, A my integer, B my integer equal to my integer of plus A dot A, there's a comma missing, B dot A. This is, this is valid Julia syntax, valid syntax code. And now I give this syntax, this Julia code to a macro, and particularly I give it to the macro eval. So what this eval macro does, it takes this Julia code as input, and well, actually it's just executes it. So it doesn't do any manipulation. It just takes this code and executes it. And it will do when operator is plus, minus, multiplication all the time for each one. So let's run this cell now. And now you see, I haven't defined plus, I haven't defined minus, but now I can do my integer of, I can do my integer one plus my integer two. And it works. And I didn't need, I can also do my integer two minus my integer three, and it works. And I didn't need to manually write that. I wrote a code which wrote the code for me. So that's very cool. That's one thing where metaprogramming is very good at. Why is eval needed here? It is because only then the op gets replaces. Okay, so this will become clear when we talk like about macros, how macros are structured. But the idea is that a macro takes an expression and first you can do some manipulation, then executes that expression. So we need the eval macro because we need to evaluate this expression. So we need to execute the Julia code. Otherwise, without the macro, this would be just a symbolic expression, would be just a set of symbols, but you wouldn't actually run the code.
So can you show what happens if you just type in the expression without eval?
Okay, yeah, so...
just to see, yeah, I mean...
Yeah, so if I do like this, it will run an error because now it expects that this is like real code, and I have this dollar op. But in a second, I will show how expressions are structured. So, but long story short, this eval, it takes this code. It stores it as an expression, and then, well, eval just executes it. So it does nothing. It's like a trivial macro. It takes the code, stores as expression, executes the expression. So it's just like a function x which returns x, basically. But yeah, you need to evaluate each one. And then this $op interpolates the value of the variable op. So in this expression, replaces op with the plus. Okay? And so this was one of the main applications of macros, which is avoid repetitive code. So that if you have a lot of functions which are very regular, you can write a macro which generates all the codes for that. Now, so I have mentioned these expressions, but what are expressions? Well, let's define one. So if I type just normal Julia code like this, a equal one, this is a trivial Julia code. If I put it around parentheses and put I'm terrible with punctuation, colon. A colon before it.
Yeah, it's a colon.
And I put a colon before it.
I'm not sure if you meant to make this cell markdown or not, but there's no syntax highlighting because of that.
No, I didn't.
So it is markdown.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so if I take Julia code, wrap it in parentheses, and put a colon about before it, it creates an expression. So now this is an expression. And an expression is a data structure to represent Julia code. So the only limitation is that the thing inside the expression must have a valid Julia syntax. So if I try to do something like, for example, this. Now, this is sometimes how you represent an half open interval, but this is not a valid Julia syntax. It gives an error, because this is not valid Julia syntax. But if I give a valid Julia syntax like this, then
make the font a bit bigger? So probably by reusing the window side. Okay, that works.
Is this good?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, sorry for that. So if you give a valid Julia syntax, an expression is just a data structure to represent Julia code. So what this eval macro does, it first takes this Julia code. You can think it puts this parentheses and colon around it. So it stores it an expression. And well, the eval is very trivial because it just executes the expression. So it just returns the expression, executes it. So it's like a wax on, wax off. But in principle, inside the macro, when you get the expression, you can do modifications, you can change it, you can alter it to Julia code, you can add pieces, replace pieces, remove pieces. And to understand it, let's see how the expression is stored. So the fundamental function when we work with the expressions is dump. And sometimes I tend to write a dump by accident, I'm not being rude, it's just like, me. So if we dump the expression, now this will print the internal representation of the expression. And this is what computer scientists call abstract syntax tree. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with the concept, but basically you can think of an abstract syntax tree of as a representation of the expression. So here, this was the expression a equal one. The head tells us what is the outermost operator. So when I do a equal one, this is like the thing that I execute, I do an assignment. So it's telling me that this expression is an assignment operator. And then it gives the arguments. So the arguments, the inputs of this assignment operator are a and one. And they're stored here as a list. A and one. Let's take a slightly bigger example. So let's create an expression, which is a plus b times c, for example, like this, okay? And now let's look at the abstract syntax tree. Now we see it says that this is a call. So this is like a statement that I execute. I sort of like call this, I execute this line. And then it says, what are the arguments of this call? Well, the arguments is, the first is this symbol multiplication. So this is the outermost operation now. And this multiplication has two inputs now, the expression and the symbol C. And this expression here is this A plus B. So it's this, again, this A plus B is an expression, which is a call. So it's like a statement which I execute. And the arguments are the function which I execute and its inputs. Okay. And if you want, it's actually a very funny exercise. I suggest you to do that. You just write Julia code, wrap it inside the, make it an expression and study what it looks like. So this is like a nice way of like, how would I say, good procrastination. Study how Julia code is represented. For example, we could do that the expression is if A is greater than one, can I do it like this? Then no, if A is, what do I want to do? I mean, for example, we can create an array, 1, 2, 3 plus 1, 2, 3. That's valid Julia syntax. And then we can look at how it's represented. Okay. And now we see this is a function call. Then the first argument is the function which I call. So I call the plus operator. The second and the third are the inputs of the function. And the inputs are again expressions. And what expressions were? A vector, an array. So this here is this array, vector inputs 1, 2, 3. And this is this array, vector 1, 2, 3. And now maybe you started to see like the cool power of metaprogramming and macros. It's that if I get this expression representation of Julia code, I can go through the tree, I can change things, I can modify and create a new Julia code. So for example, now I have this code, this expression 1, 2, 3 plus 1, 2, 3. And now suppose I want, so I want to see what it is. I want to check the head of the expression. I can do x dot head. And you'll say that this expression, it's a call. Then if I do head dot args, it will x dot args. It will print the list of arguments. And now, for example, if I want to change the plus to minus, I can do x.args one. So the first one, the plus, and I can replace it with the minus like this. And now if I look at the expression again, now it's 1, 2, 3 minus 1, 2, 3. So the power is that now I have a data structure to represent Julia code and I can play with the code. I can do whatever I want with the code. However, with great powers come great responsibilities. So this going through the syntax tree and checking that it's valid, the syntax is what the Julia compiler generally does. Now, if you are yourself messing up with the syntax tree, you now must ensure that you don't destroy the syntax tree. So you don't like destroy the code and you don't introduce invalid syntax. So now, for example, if I would replace the minus sign with something that doesn't make sense, like a 2, okay? Now it creates this nonsense where, where is the nonsense? Can you have a function named 2? I don't know, but anyway, even if it's theoretical allowed, I would argue it's not good practice. So now when you replace the minus, you said that now I'm a function called the 2, which is called to 2 arguments, vector 1, 2, 3 and vector 1, 2, 3. And
in this principle, names are not allowed to start with numbers. So
okay, so I guess
name, at least in actual code.
Yeah, I guess we can try, which are to a valid. Oh yeah, because Now I give it so eval x. Yeah, and now it says no, that doesn't make sense. You cannot, an integer is not callable. The reason why I used the eval function and not the eval macro is that now this x is already an expression. It's already written with the parentheses and colon. So it's already like stored as expression. The eval macro, it's used when you write the SGLA code, so without manually putting the parentheses like that. Yeah. Now, to give a taste of why metaprogramming could be useful, suppose you want to time a function. So yesterday we saw this at time rand, which can measure how long it takes. It's not the best way to benchmark, but it's okay. Now, for the purposes, if you want to time how the function, if you want to measure how long a function takes, how would you do it? Like manually, if you had to do it manually, you would probably like start by first like setting a timer, so something like t start equal time now. That's not the right function in Julia. I don't know how to get the current time, but you like do something like get current time, something like this. Then you would execute the function, measure the new time, t stop, get current time, and return t stop minus t start. That's what you would like to do. So you would like to wrap the function that you want to measure inside this. So first set the timer, run the function, take the new time, and the difference is the measured time. And you don't want to do it manually every time. You don't want to write all the lines this way. So what the time macro does in practice, it does exactly this. So it takes this function and then puts some other code before and after it. Now you probably don't believe me, so I'll show you. I actually went looking for the source code of the time macro inside the Julia source code, because you know it's open source, so everybody can read the source code. Okay, I guess it doesn't matter if it's a little out of the cell. So that's how the macro is defined. So the definition starts with macro, similar to function, but now it's macro, the name of the macro and the input, so this expression. And now if, so this expression is the code that I'm giving it. In this case, it would be rand. And now, okay, quote end is just another way of doing the parentheses and colon. So if it's a longer code, it might be annoying to write in parentheses and colon. So you can do quote end to write longer pieces of code. So it's, but this is the same of creating expression. So this is an expression. It creates the expression with quote end. Then it adds some code before. I don't know what this is, some compiler heuristics, but you see it's, at some point it takes the elapsed time. So it measures the time before executing. Then now we have this dollar x. I'm not going to talk about this ask because it's a little beyond, but forget about ask at the moment. This is similar to what we had before. So dollar x, the interpolation. So now it's assigning the result of this function to a local variable. And then it's measuring the time again after the execution and subtracting the starting time from it. So you see it's wrapping these lines of code around our original code. So that's what a macro does. It allows you to manipulate code, like add code, remove code, modify code. So it's a very powerful way to create code. And one peculiarity of the macros is that a macro must return an expression. So this quote end is an expression. And the expression which is returned is also executed. So conceptually, what a macro does, it, now I want markdown. What a macro does, so first, stores the input code as expression. Then it does something, what you want to do, like add add code before, add code after, and so on and so on. Return an expression. So you remember from yesterday in Julia, the last line is executed. So this is like return quote end. So it's returning this expression and evaluating the expression, which means it converts it back to Julia code. So from expression to Julia code, and it runs that code. So basically with a macro, it's what I would do, what I did before manually. You remember I wrote the expression manually and then I used eval. The macro does this writing expression and eval in one step. Are there questions? Not in the chat? Okay.
No.
Do we have time for a small demo?
Maybe before that, I will start writing the feedback section in the
Oh, yeah, that's a great point. Yeah, that's a fantastic.
So, okay, well, I'll just do the end speech. So, I mean, I don't have much to say except thanks for joining us, for coming on the course. Thanks also for the great questions and for helping us improve the material for later. So, I will basically write the same kinds of things that we had in the feedback section yesterday. I will also add a separate question about each of the sections. Anything, I'll just write something positive also, but especially any way we can improve this course, because we are running it for the first, well, essentially the second time.
For me, it's the first.
So, yeah, really the first time. Thanks for attending, and I will let Luca continue while I write in the Hackambi. So it can then go over time if you want to.
Yeah. So that's maybe a little too mathematical example. I'm sorry for, I hope it doesn't bother anyone, but basically the Wilkinson polynomial is this polynomial defined like this. So for example, like x minus 1 times x minus 2 times x minus 3 times x minus 4 times x minus 5 would be like the polynomial of degree 5. So you see the structure. It's hard to explain in words, but when you see this, I guess you get the structure, like x minus 1 times x minus 2 up to x minus 5. And this is an example where you could write a function for that. So you could write a function, Wilkinson, which takes the order n and the point at which you want to evaluate. And then you can compute. So this would be the product of a minus I for I in 1 to n, like this. That's pretty much rewriting the function. So I can create it like this. However, one thing that I could also do is that I would like to generate this expression. So as I did here manually, I wrote like manually that P5 of X is this. I wrote manually this function. And what are the advantages of like writing like this compared to writing like this? The advantage is this is now a constant expression, so the compiler can optimize this, can do some smarter things. And well, x minus 1 up to x minus 5, it's still okay to write manually, but I don't want to write manually x minus 6, x minus 7 until x minus 100. Okay, so I would like to create this expression. I would like to generate this expression. So what I want to do, I want to create a macro, make Wilkinson n, which takes as input a number n and returns this function, creates this function. That's what I want to do. I want to write a macro which generates for me a function to compute the Wilkinson polynomial of degree n. And okay, let's do it. So when I create this macro, this n is now a number. And first I initialize my expression. So x now, this x minus one, n must be at least one, will be x minus one, like this. This expression. Okay. And now I want to add the pieces to this expression. So what I want to do is that for I in 2 to n, I want to add the x minus 2, x minus 3, x minus 4, and so on until x minus n. So what I will do, x, okay, is an expression. And then the first part will be x. And now I must use this dollar sign because I'm interpolating inside the expression. If I just wrote it like this, then it would just put the symbol x here. Whereas I want to put the content of the variable x inside the expression. So I must interpolate. And then I add the piece which I want. So times x minus I. And again, now I must put dollar I, because if I wrote just like this, it would add x minus I, like it would add this to the expression. When I put the dollar, it interpolates it and creates this x minus I. Okay. All right. Okay, let's change the definition a little. That let's have it also take a second parameter, which is the name. Okay, so the order and the name of how I want to call the function. Then I want to construct the function. I want it to look like, for example, that if the name is p5, p5 of x equal x minus 1 times blah, blah, blah. And this x minus 1 times blah, 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 I already constructed here. It's this one. Now I want to add this piece here. So again, what I do, I create the expression, name. So now I'm interpolating the name. Then x equal, do I need parentheses here? I'm not sure, but let's put it to be safe. X equal x. So now in this expression here, inside on the right side of the equal sign, we'll put the content of this expression. And on the left side, we'll replace the name with the value of the name. So it will create an expression which looks like this. And since this is a macro, this expression, which is returned, will also be automatically evaluated. So it will actually like generate the code and execute the code. So let's write. Now, suppose I want to call the function p6. Let's first prove that I don't have p6. p6 not defined. Now I do make Wilkinson 6, degree 6, and I want to call it p6.